Hi, thank you everyone for coming on a Friday night. This is very exciting. You'll be very happy you're here. I just want to introduce a little bit about Deepa. She's been doing amazing work for the past 10-15 years, and I want to do her justice by reading the full bio. As a senior fellow at the Center for Social Inclusion, Deepa Iyer provides analysis, commentary, and scholarship on the ways to build racial equality and solidarity in light of the rapid demographic transformation in America's neighborhoods, schools, and workplace. Deepa is an attorney who has worked on civil and immigrant rights issues in the nonprofit and governmental sectors for 15 years. Deepa served as executive director of South Asian Americans Leading Together, SALT, for a decade. While at SALT, I see some people support. While at SALT, Deepa shaped the formation of the National Coalition of South Asian Organizations, NCSO, a network of local South Asian groups, and served as chair of the National Coalition of Asian Pacific American of Asian Americans. I want to welcome Deepa. I want to congratulate her on this beautiful book, and she'll start with a presentation, and we can go on into the conversation afterwards. So, Deepa, thank you for coming. Let's get ready.
Hi, everyone. How are you doing? Good. Thanks so much for coming out. I'm going to see if I can sit up here and manage my PowerPoint at the same time.
Ooh,
maybe not. Okay, we'll try it. So, first of all, I really wanted to thank CUNY and the Asian American Research Institute for hosting this, and really thankful to Anthony who put it together, who's back there, and also wanted to thank Zohra, who is a friend and a poet, an Afghan American poet based in Brooklyn, whose writing I hope you will not miss. You can learn more about her via her Twitter as well as her website, zohrasaed.com. And if you want to tweet with us, you can, or Instagram with us. The hashtag is WeTooSingAmerica, and here are some of the Twitter handles. So as Zohra said, I wanted to take a little bit of time to just do a presentation about some of the themes in the book. And after that, I think will be the more exciting part, which is that we will be in conversation with each other and also include you as well in that conversation. So let me start out a little bit by telling you a little bit about myself and my own point of entry into this work and into the writing of this book. So I'm an immigrant who was born and raised in India, in Kerala, India, to these two wonderful people on the right. And due to a lot of privileges that my parents and many other immigrants got as a result of the 1965 immigration laws, we were able to move to the United States when I was 12 years old. And my parents settled us in, believe it or not, Kentucky, Louisville, Kentucky. And so growing up in Kentucky in the mid-80s as an Indian American Hindu immigrant was very confusing in terms of figuring out what my race was, figuring out how I was situated in a very black or white binary in Kentucky at the time. So as I grew up, and that's me with the hands on her hips, if you couldn't tell, the one with leadership skills, right? Not bossy, as my brother would say. But as I grew up in the South and eventually moved to the East Coast in the late 90s, a lot of things started to become clearer for me. But for me, my turning point and my point of entry, I would say, in terms of racial consciousness happened in the days and months after the attacks here in New York City and in Washington on September 11, 2001. At the time, I was an attorney at the U.S. Department of Justice in Washington, and within hours of hearing about the attacks, which obviously were unbelievably devastating for people who lived in these cities and were connected to these communities, we began to hear reports of people who were Sikh, South Asian, Muslim, Arab, or perceived to be from these communities being harassed, being chased down streets in Manhattan, being profiled on airports, in airports and on trains, and even being subjected to hate violence. And this is a picture of a press conference that Asian Americans, South Asian activists held at the Japanese American Memorial in Washington, D.C., about 4 days after 9/11, sending a call to our community to remember not to return to the days of World War II and internment, which is what this memorial reminds us, and what is rather unfortunate is that just about a couple of months ago in mid-December, Asian Americans convened again at this memorial to send a similar message, given the rates of hate violence and profiling and discrimination we've seen since the attacks in Paris and San Bernardino. So, as Zohra mentioned, the turning point for me after 9/11 led me to run a national organization that was focused on the rights of South Asian Americans in the United States, South Asian Americans leading together for about a decade, and really focusing in on community building in our communities and making sure that there was power that was built in our communities. And since then, I have been focused on issues around brown and black solidarity, specifically in light of the many social change movements that are happening in this country and in light of the demographics. So enough about me, but that's a little bit of background as to why I wanted to write the book. And the book, you know, is really what I hope it is that it is a history, a living history of lived experiences of South Asian, Muslim, Arab, and Sikh immigrant communities. I often teach classes on Asian American issues at the University of Maryland, where I live. And I noticed that my students who were probably, you know, in kindergarten when 9/11 happened, have a very sanitized an incomplete understanding of what the post 9/11 environment is. And so that is why I hope that this book is a bit of a knowledge gap filler. But it's also a call to action for the communities that I write about, a call to action for us to really center our racial identities and our racial solidarities, especially in this political moment. And lastly, hoping that the book provides some ideas. I hope that it's not kind of a resource only, but that it's an actual toolkit that people can use to engage in more conversations about the intersections of race, national origin, and faith in the United States. So with that, really quickly, you know, we'll talk a little bit more about what the book's about when Zohra gets up on the chair. But the book is really told through the lens of young people under the age of 35 who are at the front lines of a lot of the issues that are affecting South Asian, Arab, Muslim, and Sikh immigrants. So, for example, includes the story of Mustafa, who's a young activist in St. Louis who has been on the ground working with the Movement for Black Lives, or Droost, who is a young Muslim Kurdish refugee in Nashville, Tennessee, who has been part of a movement to push back against the really virulent anti-Muslim rhetoric that has been pervasive in the state of Tennessee. So it tells stories of young people like that all around the country who are, I think, leading the way for our communities in terms of addressing these issues in a very, in a way that is collaborative and also very courageous. So I want to just tell you a little bit about the themes in the book that are focused on the post 9/11 environment. And what the book argues is that there are three forces that have come together to create the post 9/11 environment of backlash. One is state policy. So whether it's at the local level or at the federal level, a range of policies that are focused on national security and immigration as ways and tools to really surveil our communities, to spy on our communities, to deport and detain people in our communities. The second force is one-on-one individual racism. That includes hate violence, discrimination at the workplace, or bullying at schools. And the third is narrative formation. So the narrative that our community members are disloyal, worthy of suspicion, likely terrorists. And that narrative has been constructed both in the media, but it's also voiced in what political leaders say, elected officials say as well. So those three forces have come together to create an environment where we have rampant anti-immigrant sentiment, racial anxiety, as well as Islamophobia that affect these communities on a daily basis in their daily lives. And so I wanted to show a couple of visuals that are also contained in the book, but this particular picture is of the brother of Balbir Singh Sodhi, who was the first Sikh American to be killed in about a week after 9/11 as he was tending to his garden outside a gas station that he owned in Mesa, Arizona. So hate violence is something that we have seen continued, and I'll talk about that a little bit more in the United States. But it also extends to, again, as I said, government policies. So we call many of the people who were detained and interrogated in the months after 9/11 the disappeared, because we actually don't know what happened to them. They were rounded up and then taken away. airport profiling, and even the school-to-prison pipeline. This is a picture of Ahmed Mohammed, who you might remember brought in a homemade clock to school in Texas just last year and was basically jailed and taken to juvenile detention. Even in our places of worship, many community members feel that they are not safe. So signs like these on mosques. This is a Hindu temple in Seattle, Washington. And then the narrative, right? The narrative that is basically around the fact that our communities don't belong here, that we should go home, that this is not our country, that America has been invaded. And in many ways, I really think that what we're seeing now, which is the out and out overt language like this, the racial anxiety that is coming up because of the demographic changes, I think that we saw previews of that over the last 15 years since 9/11 with these particular communities who have had to deal with this sort of language in the decade and a half after 9/11. So those three forces and the three tools and strategies in which we've seen the post 9/11 backlash manifest itself has, as I mentioned, taken a daily toll on the lives of people, how they decide to, whether they decide to wear a hijab or a turban, whether they decide to speak their own language on the street, whether they decide to go to their mosque or gurdwara or temple. All of these daily decisions are marked and tinged by the post 9/11 environment for our communities. So with that, I wanted to actually read to you a passage or two from the book. And the passage I wanted to read is actually from the first chapter, and it's called Not Our American Dream. It focuses on the massacre that happened at the Gurdwara in Oak Creek, Wisconsin. Are most of you familiar with that? There was an act of hate violence that occurred in 2012 at a Sikh temple in Oak Creek, Wisconsin. So this is about that. It was early on a Sunday morning in August 2012, and Paramjeet Kaur Saini was going about her morning routine. Her sons, 20-year-old Kamal and 18-year-old Harpreet, wanted to sleep in a little longer. So Paramjeet set out on her own to the local gurdwara, the Sikh temple of Wisconsin. Paramjeet was a familiar presence at the gurdwara, which had become a second home to her family and to so many other Sikhs in Oak Creek, which is a small city located in the outskirts of Milwaukee. The gurdwara, built in 2007 on 13 acres of land by Sikh immigrant families, sits just a few miles from the Milwaukee airport. On weekends, Sikh families gathered at the gurdwara to pray and connect with one another. The dining hall was filled with the sounds of people laughing and socializing during langar, which is a free meal offered to anyone who came to the gurdwara. Kamal and Harpreet usually hung out with their friends and played football on Sundays, while their mother helped in the kitchen and prayer hall. But August 5th, 2012 would not turn out to be a normal Sunday for Paramjeet's family or for the Oak Creek community. Soon after his mother had left the house, news reached Kamal that people inside the Sikh Temple of Wisconsin were in danger. Details were scarce, and panic-stricken, Kamal rushed to the gurdwara to find that law enforcement vehicles had blocked off the driveway. Authorities asked him to wait across the street in the parking lot of a bowling alley, where he joined others, also anxiously searching for information. While waiting there, Kamal and others speculated about what might be happening inside the gurdwara. They wondered, did a dispute between community members go awry? Then their close friend Kirandeep received a call from her father, who was inside the gurdwara. He whispered to her that he was hiding in the pantry of the kitchen because he had heard gunshots. He was one of around 25 people huddled, terrified, among bags of rice and fresh vegetables. Kirandeep's father told her not to come to the gurdwara under any circumstances. As the day wore on, many of the people who had been inside were allowed to leave, and a fuller picture began to emerge about the rampage that had occurred in the gurdwara that Sunday morning. Not seeing his mother and becoming increasingly anxious about her safety, Kamal left the parking lot. He called his friends, and together they went from hospital to hospital, hoping that Paramjeet had been brought to one. It would be a full 11 hours before authorities finally notified Kamal that his mother had been one of six people fatally shot inside the gurdwara. "When I first found out, I passed out," Kamal told me. "I woke up in an ambulance and immediately thought of my little brother. telling him was the hardest thing that I have ever done. This was not the future that Paramjit had envisioned for her family when she and her two sons moved to America from India in 2004 to join her husband, who owned a number of gas stations in Wisconsin. And it was not the life that Paramjit had planned to build when she mustered up the courage a few years later to begin working at a medical factory in a nearby town. Paramjit's determination to care for her family is a point of deep pride for her sons. 45 days after his mother was killed, Harpreet spoke about her in testimony before the United States Senate. He said, "My mother was a brilliant woman, a reasonable woman. Everyone knew she was smart, but she never had the chance to get a formal education. She couldn't. As a hardworking immigrant, she had to work long hours to feed her family, to get her sons educated, and to help us achieve our American dreams. This was more important to her than anything else. But now she's gone. Because of a man who killed her, because she wasn't his color or his religion, she was an American, and this was not our American dream." So what we learned later is that a white supremacist named Wade Michael Page had barged into the Gurdwara that morning and, as the book tells, killed six people and terrorized the community, including young children who were inside the Gurdwara at the time. And many young children actually lost loved ones, like Kamal and Harpreet lost loved ones in this particular tragedy. And the chapter goes on to talk about how this community responded, this small community in the Midwest, how it responded to this horrific act of hate violence, not just the Sikh community, but how people from other parts of the country came in to intervene in support, and how government responded, and also provides some recommendations for how we plan and prepare and respond in case other acts of hate violence occur, which unfortunately do continue to occur. So I want to read to you a little bit more from this particular chapter that sets a historical context as well for what happened. So those South Asian Arab, Hindu, Muslim, and Sikh communities experienced unprecedented backlash after 9/11. Hate violence targeting these communities, as you know, has a much longer history. Arabs in particular have faced high levels of suspicion, discrimination, and violence in the late 70s and the early 90s when the Iran hostage crisis and the Persian Gulf War occurred. And for South Asians, especially those who are Hindu, Muslim, or Sikh, they have been targets of hate crimes from Bellingham, Washington, riots in 1907, to the Dotbuster scare in the 1980s in New Jersey, and street violence that has been targeting immigrants in recent decades. The riots in Bellingham, which occurred in the early part of the 20th century, are meaningful in understanding the roots of anti-Asian sentiment. At the time, all along the West Coast, Chinese, Korean, Filipino, Japanese, and Indian workers were exploited for their labor, but not welcomed as residents or U.S. citizens. These racist attitudes, reinforced by laws such as the Chinese Exclusion Act and anti-naturalization policies, often took the form of actual violence. And that's what happened on September 4th, 1907 in Bellingham, Washington, where 500 white residents rounded up around 200 South Asian migrant workers, most of them Sikhs and Hindus, and locked them in the basement of the city hall. They intended to drive out these immigrant laborers who worked in Bellingham's lumber mills. Unsurprisingly, Bellingham's xenophobic reactions to South Asian migrant labor reflected the views that were already institutionalized in law and expressed in the media. The Bellingham Herald, this particular newspaper, published an editorial the day after the riots that read, "The Hindu is not a good citizen. It would require centuries to assimilate him, and this country need not take the trouble. Our racial burdens are already heavy enough to bear." So just as a footnote, about 100 years later, the editors of the Bellingham Herald published an apology. Took 100 years, but they did it after all. So the point that I wanted to make with bringing this up is, and the book talks about this, is that, again, what happened after 9/11 was not an isolated phenomenon. The racist attitudes that our communities have been subjected to goes back to the turn of the 20th century, right? And this is just one example of many others that affected many different types of Asian laborers who were working in up and down the West Coast of the United States. And the book talks a little bit more about the Dotbusters. It talks about the case of Rishi Maharaj, a young man who was the victim of hate violence in Queens, and other people who have endured hate violence before 9/11. So I want to end by reading you just a little bit to go return us actually back to Oak Creek, Wisconsin, and to the memorial. I arrived in Oak Creek 5 days after the massacre occurred to pay my respects at the memorial for the 6 victims of the tragedy. As I approached Oak Creek High School, the site of the memorial service, I could see hundreds of people waiting in line outside. People of all races and faiths had gathered in the quintessential American space, a high school gymnasium, to mourn the 6 Sikh immigrants who had lost their lives to hate violence in America's heartland. The gym echoed with a spontaneous call and response of Bole So Nihal, Sat Sri Akal, from the 6 in the audience. As the memorial program began, we were asked to pay our respect to the victims by lining up to view the caskets. I tried to prepare myself for looking into the faces of the 6 innocent people who had lost their lives, but I was even more shaken as I realized that next to each casket stood their children and loved ones. What do you say to comfort a child who had lost a parent in an act of hate? Next to Satwant Singh Kaleka's casket stood his 2 adult sons, Amardeep and Pardeep, who would become leading national voices in efforts to end gun and hate violence. Flanking Ranjit Singh's casket was his 14-year-old son, Gurvinder. And next to Paramjit Kaur's casket stood Kamal and Harpreet, whom I would meet for the first time. I murmured the only words of comfort and reassurance that I could muster. "Our communities will stand by you," I said. I believed these words fully in my heart, but I also knew that they could provide little solace at the time. The memorial service proceeded with a number of speeches from community leaders and elected officials, and among them was Attorney General Eric Holder, who had traveled to Oak Creek. He said, "Unfortunately, this sort of hate violence has become all too common in recent years. In the recent past, too many Sikhs have been targeted and victimized simply because of who they are, how they look, and what they believe." The public backlash that Sikhs, Hindus, Muslims, South Asians, and Arabs have experienced since 9/11 did not happen in a vacuum. And this violence has been reinforced by racist, anti-Muslim, and xenophobic political rhetoric, media narratives, and by the government's own policies and practices that have targeted our communities in the name of national security. So just to kind of finish, before I actually get to the rest of it, I just wanted to see if we could just have a moment of silence for the victims of Oak Creek and for other tragedies around the country, because I know that those are heavy passages to hear and read, so just to think about Kamal and his family as well. Thank you. So the rest of my PowerPoint is actually focused on the resistance to this sort of bias and injustice that our communities have faced. And this resistance has its roots, again, in movements that predate us, right? So whether it was actually the people who came to the United States at the turn of the 20th century and pushed back on those types of Bellingham riots and the Chinese Exclusion Act, or whether it's people in the 1960s, Asian Americans who very clearly aligned with the Black Power movement at the time, right? We have examples of resistance and organizing and brown and black solidarity in our communities. Justice for Vincent Chin, the movement that happened in Detroit after the killing of Vincent Chin, for example, is another example of how Asian Americans have come together to demand justice. These pictures actually taken by Corky Lee, who's an Asian American photographer here, actually are about a group of Indian youth against racism who organized in light of what happened in New Jersey with the Dot Busters. And we don't usually see these visuals, right? Because we don't think that this sort of organizing occurred in our communities, but we do have a history of it. And we have often, I think, forgotten that it exists in our communities. And now, more recently, I think that the way in which South Asians are making their voices heard is very clearly and loudly by talking about how they operate at the intersections of various forms of injustice. They see and queer, for example, or class, working class communities. This is a group that is right here in Jackson Heights, Stacey's Rising Up and Moving, that not only talks about class and immigration issues, but also talks about racial profiling issues as well. Adhikar, an organization again here in Jackson, in Queens, which is organizing domestic workers and connecting Nepali domestic workers to Filipino domestic workers, for example, and making the connections. Undocumented immigrants. This is a picture of Bhupen, who's also featured in my book, a young man in Los Angeles who's undocumented and who has been one of the leading voices and faces in the movement that is led by undocumented youth. Education, not deportation, right? And at the same time that our communities have been in chaos in the post 9/11 moment, we have also seen other social change movements emerge. And one of the most prominent ones, of course, is a movement for Black Lives, which tells us with urgency to say her name and to remember that police violence affects Black communities on a daily basis and is born out of history of violence and disinvestment in Black communities. And South Asians and Muslims and Arabs and Sikh communities have been standing in solidarity with the movement for Black Lives. And it is a process that I think we are still trying to figure out. There's a chapter in my book called Ferguson is Everywhere that tries to touch upon some of the ways in which we are asserting our solidarity. And I think what we're trying to figure out is how we do it. How are we allies? What is our role in also understanding and addressing the criminal justice system? This is a picture of a really powerful picture of young people that are part of Daisy's Rising Up and Moving, who walk down a street, I think it's Roosevelt Avenue in Jackson Heights, holding up their hands. Hands up, don't shoot, right? It's a very powerful image to see young people doing that in coalition. And I think we're also trying to figure out, in addition to standing in solidarity and being allies and dealing with the criminal justice movement, how we address the anti-Black racism within our own communities, and in a way that's concerted, that's deep, and that is thoughtful. This is one of my favorite signs because it's from the University of Maryland where I teach. Yellow Peril loves, supports, and protects Black power in Washington, D.C. And the last two images I'll show you also are around solidarity, and this is to connect us back to Oak Creek. This is a gurdwara. Every year, every August, the community, the young people in Oak Creek hold a memorial for the six victims, and this past year, it occurred a few months after the hate violence in South Carolina, and where a man walked into a Black church, right? And so this year, last year, the community held up pictures and put pictures up of the victims of that particular tragedy to show the connection, not just in terms of the hate violence that affected the church and the gurdwara in Wisconsin and South Carolina, but also to show that the communities are linked and connected in terms of how they are going to be responding to hate violence together, hand in hand. And lastly, a picture of Arab, Muslim, South Asian leaders with Black and Latino and indigenous leaders outside a mosque in Murfreesboro, Tennessee. The Black and Latino leaders traveled from all around the country to show their support for a mosque that has actually endured a lot of hate violence, vandalism, and obstruction over the last 4 years. So these examples of brown and Black solidarity, for me, are inspiring ones because they remind us that we have similar oppressions and shared fates and shared futures. And there is an opportunity right now, especially as our demographic landscape switches, and in this political moment, to build these alliances in a deeper and more meaningful way so that we can create the America that we want to. So with that, I will end, and I will turn it over to Zohra. But I want to thank you for listening, and we're going to have a conversation, and we have books for sale if you're interested, and I would love to talk to you and learn about who you each of you is as well. But first, I'm going to turn it over to Zohra.
Well, I just want to we can all be in conversation with her. I think the photos have really done a lot to bring the chapters to life, especially for me. I think the way the book is there's life story, someone's life history, and then we get all the historical facts and the legal. We get all the legal information as well, and that way we get an education without realizing we've been educated. So I appreciate all the photos, especially the archival ones and the connections with different communities. So I can do one question. Do you want to ask something after seeing this? Do you want to respond? And then I'll weave in a question, and then we could go back and forth. That way we can all kind of have this conversation. We're a small enough group, I think, to do this. If you have a question now for her, do you want to start off, or should I warm up? I'll warm up, and then you guys come in when it opens.
So there are a few things you said about these connections, but you also say something in the book about, I'll just read the question. You ask us to reject the racial bribe and to be disruptors of the status quo. So what do you mean by that? Within the South Asian, Arab, Muslim, mm-hmm. Hindu, Sikh communities, and sort of give up these... tell me a little bit.
So that's part of that call to action that I have mm-hmm. for our own communities in the book. And the racial bribe is a concept that sociologists, particularly Lani Gunier in her book, The Miner's Canary, put out there. And what it is that we have a racial ladder or hierarchy in the United States, right? If you want to visualize it in that way, where often whiteness is at the top and blackness is at the bottom. And other communities are sort of on the middle rungs of that particular ladder. But the ladder is there to maintain systems of anti-black racism or indigenous invisibility, systems of oppression that are focused on marginalizing communities of color. And so for our communities, oftentimes, not for everyone, right, but for many who are privileged by virtue of economic class opportunities, immigration opportunities, linguistic opportunities, we are often asked to take what is called the racial bribe, which is an invitation to climb the ladder and to get closer to whiteness. And so what that looks like is that we don't actually talk about race. We don't talk about issues that are part of the book or the visuals that you saw, right? We ignore them. We diminish them. We use tropes around being a model minority or being culturally exceptional to explain our successes. So we don't really look at the systemic and structural issues that create these, the lack of opportunity for communities of color or these sorts of situations where people face racism. So what I ask in the book, and it's not a new thing, is for people to decline the racial bribe and to say, no, we're not going to talk it. Instead, we're not going to take it. Instead, we are going to disrupt the status quo. We're going to start talking about race more openly. We're going to actually care about whether, you know, the Hindu community in Nashville is going to care that the Muslim community in Murfreesboro is undergoing so much virulent racism, and will actually stand up for them instead of pretending that that's not us, that's not our community. So those are just a few examples in ways in which we can disrupt the racial ladder, dismantle it, mm-hmm. and say no to the racial bribe where we're climbing the ladder.
Something else that really stands out for me, unless you have something to add to this, but something that stands out for me from your book is where, and this is probably close to home for CUNY, in CUNY Staten Island, I think it was, a student, a Pakistani illegal, just to go, because you also talk mm-hmm. about undocumented student youth and the call to action and connecting across different activist communities, that she goes as a Pakistani undocumented hijab-wearing mm-hmm. woman to this undocumented activist organization that is predominantly Latino. So, and then she says that she wants to prove that mm-hmm. she's not, you know, the model minority, and she wants mm-hmm. to break that myth and create mm-hmm. these boundaries. And it seems the same with Oak Creek, because they also go out and make connections outside. There's mm-hmm. one with the church.
Yes. And I think that is something that in all of the various movements that I talk about and these activists, one really important strategy or tool is to make the connection with other communities of color or other immigrant communities. Not just to say, well, this is who we are, but to say, what are the connections between us? So that example of Hina, who's a young Pakistani American student at CUNY, Staten Island, or she was at the time I wrote the book. She worked at a Latino organization in Staten Island, and she's, you know, says, I would be in my hijab, and people who are Latino would speak to me in Spanish and say, what are you doing here? They were shocked that when she revealed that she too is undocumented and she's Pakistani. And there's a growing South Asian undocumented community, actually. Undocumented Indians are the fourth largest undocumented population in the United States. But the example of Hina doing what she did and does is a way in which those narratives that we often have that, well, all undocumented people are Latino in this country, right? She was able to break that, but she was also able to use her ability to navigate in that community and take it back to her own, because there's so much shame in our communities in terms of revealing that you are different, that you are undocumented. So I think that working in the Latino community gave her the courage to go back to her own Pakistani community to say, yes, I am, but I am not alone, or I'm not unique. So I think it goes both ways.
Yeah. Well, I think that strikes a bell with CUNY, right? The
yeah.
activist community. All right. So you also say, okay, so in the text you write about the racial flashpoints such as Oak Creek and Park 51, and you connect those, which I think is interesting. What's the impact of these types of incidents on communities in this 9/11, post-9/11 yeah. backlash?
Well, you know, I think that what's happening, and we don't have enough information about this, but one thing that I think we need more information about is the psychological impact. You know, one of my friends who's in the book, who's an activist here in New York City, Linda Sarsour, talks often about the 9/11 generation. And she says, you know, there is a whole group of people who have grown up as part of the 9/11 generation, people who are Arab, Muslim, South Asian, Sikh immigrants. And they don't know anything else, right? They've gone through school, they've completed their educations, they've lived their lives in this country, always feeling that they are different, that they're not welcome, that they don't belong. And they see these narratives constantly on television. So I think the psychological impact of that needs to be captured. There's a woman in the book that I mentioned earlier, Drust, who's a Kurdish Muslim mm-hmm. refugee in Tennessee. Tennessee has the largest Kurdish refugee population, by the way, in the whole country. But Drust says, you know, she started seeing all of this anti-Muslim narrative on television constantly. And she says, you know, that really took a toll on me. All of us began to think, the Muslim students began to think that something was wrong with us. And so how do we break that narrative, right? How do we break that psychological impact on us constantly feeling like we are on the margins? So that psychological piece, I think we still have to understand more. Mm-hmm. But other ways in which it's affecting people are obviously employment discrimination in the workplace, where people are not being promoted or hired because they come from these communities. Students being bullied. We have reports showing that Sikh children in New York City and even in California are reporting very high rates of bullying based mm-hmm. on their faith. And we're also seeing the school-to-prison pipeline, more enforcement, where students who are Muslim or Arab or South Asian are singled out for very small kinds of acts, right, of discipline. But their discipline is you're going to juvenile detention or you're going to be arrested, right? So these sorts of enforcement measures and the discrimination and the narratives are taking a toll in terms of how people study, how they live their daily lives, how they express their faith. Even how they, as you all probably know, the NYPD has been surveilling these communities for years since 9/11, right? Mm-hmm. And they do it at restaurants, Muslim students associations, and where people play cricket and soccer. So that's what I mean when I'd say mm-hmm. the daily life of deciding whether you can go play in your cricket match on a Sunday morning in a park in Brooklyn. Mm-hmm. It's gotten to that level where people are self-censoring and self-editing themselves in terms of what they can do, wear, express, or say.
That's wonderful. Also, I want to go back to that comment about the demographics changing. You said the last 15 years have been leading to building in unrest. So if we do look ahead, you do mention 2043.
Yeah.
2043, that is. When you say people of color will comprise the majority of the population in the U.S. So what's your vision, your hope? Mm-hmm. What do you think?
Yeah, well, the demographic changes are already happening, and you're obviously in a city where they've been happening for a while, where people of color are the majority population. Mm-hmm. And I think it was September 2014, 2014, the Department of Education revealed data that said that for the first time in American history, students of color surpassed white students in public schools. So the sea change is happening, right? And what I think is interesting is that two responses are occurring at the same time. One is that there's tremendous anxiety among some people in this country, not only white people, even people who are, I think, of color and immigrants as well, who have this anxiety that America is changing and America is shifting, right? The true nature of who we are is changing because we have this, quote, multicultural, diverse population. And that all of a sudden, the benefits and privileges and access that people have been accustomed to will soon be taken away, or they'll be dispersed, so we don't have as much, right? So that anxiety is leading to a lot of results, right? I mean, everything from some of the rhetoric you're hearing from political leaders at this time, I won't mention any names, or the rise in hate groups, in white supremacist hate groups, which are specifically talking about the demographic changes as a reason for them to organize and mobilize. So that's one trend. But the other trend, the trend that I am hopeful about, is again, the ability of communities of color and progressive white people to organize together, to build alliances, and to think about what a multiracial, equitable, inclusive country looks like, school, workplace, community looks like, right? And so I think those are the movements and those are the people and the actions that give me hope in terms of pushing back against this anxiety and racism that we're seeing becoming very overt, very explicit, even in the political and media systems. Mm-hmm. So those are the two trends that I think, you know, might be simplistic, but that's kind of what I think is happening in the country. And so that is why for these communities in particular, it is going to be so important to organize ourselves, to center our racial identities, and to be in racial solidarity with others.
Good, good. Thank you. Questions from you now? Yes.
So I'll ask a question. You know, after the Suresh Bhai Patel, you know, incident, you know, there was a lot of, you know, response from the South Asian community and all of that. And there was an issue of, can people hear me?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. You know, in contrast with many people, particularly on my Facebook feed or the people from my South Asian community and stuff, you didn't see as much of a response around a lot of the incidents, you know, that galvanized the Black Lives Matter. And it was something that it kind of showed that there was a real need to kind of see ourselves in all of those things. But another example that I think, so that's around, you know, building that alliance. But then even, you know, I know you've done a lot of work around the Purvi Patel issue, and that to me is also very interesting because that's within our community and this kind of respectability politics and stuff where, you know, even for someone within the community who is, you know, just really suffering the legal system, there isn't this kind of widespread support because of wanting to, even within the community, otherize, you know, her for various reasons. So I'm just curious about how you talk about that, you know, especially with folks who somehow don't see that as very, very critical to address within the community.
Yeah, no, thank you. I think that the two different questions, right? So one on Suresh Bhai Patel, I don't know if folks know who he is, but he is an Indian grandfather who was taking a walk in his neighborhood in Madison, Alabama last February, and there was a tip made to the police department that there was a suspicious Black guy in the neighborhood. And the police showed up, and in the encounter, where it was very clear that Mr. Patel didn't speak any English at all, all he could say was India in response to the questions. But the police officer, one of the police officers, assaulted him, and the assault led to partial paralysis of Mr. Patel. And as you pointed out, Kavita, the incident, I think, did galvanize a lot of South Asian Americans who, I think, for the first time, eyes were opened, right, in terms of, so this is what people in the movement for Black Lives are talking about when they talk about Michael Brown or Tamir Rice or Rekia Boyd or any of the other people that we've been, you know, hearing about and thinking about. So I think it opened eyes, but I think that's, you know, it's one of those things I think in the South Asian community in particular, when it happens to one of us, then it's like, oh, this is a problem, you know, this is a structural problem, right? So what has happened, I think, as a response is that people have become more aware of the problems in the criminal justice system. They've become more clear that our communities are looked upon as racial subjects who can be terrorized, who can be assaulted and brutalized in this way by the state. And I think there's also been an opportunity for a lot of young people to start talking to their parents' generation about anti-Black racism. So that case has opened up these different opportunities, definitely. Whether or not South Asians will actually stay in solidarity with the Movement for Black Lives or start to work on the structural and systemic issues around criminal justice remains to be seen. But I do think that that case was a mobilizer. The other case you talk about, Purvi Patel, no relation between the two, but Purvi Patel is a young woman in Indiana. You may have read about her last year. She became the first woman at all in the United States to be convicted and sent to prison for a miscarriage. And she was basically charged with feticide in the state of Indiana for deliberately killing her own baby. There are a lot of facts in that case. If you're interested in looking her up, you can find out. But that particular case, I think, angered and mobilized some parts of our community. But again, I think that it was, you know, I remember talking to my own parents about it, and it's hard to have those conversations because there is this sense of, like you said earlier, like there's some sort of shame, right, or a cultural shaming of what, you know, oh, she had a baby and she wasn't married, right? So that cultural shaming continues to occur. The other rising continues to occur, not wanting to talk about it, right? And so I think that as we hear of more of these instances, which we will, because our communities are complicated and complex, we can see them as opportunities to talk about the structural issues, to talk about the racial bribe, right? And hopefully mobilize ourselves around them and the first generation, as we call it, of our parents as well.
First of all, I want to congratulate and appreciate you doing this kind of work. I think it's very important for everybody to learn about this thing. One thing I feel like, I mean, what you're trying to do is educate people, mm-hmm. which I think is very central part of system, like educate, right?
Yeah.
Me growing up in India, we were like taught from that when you're younger, Muslim and Hindu are like brothers, right? It's very important, these kind of things, like especially the hate is growing and growing every day. And you're seeing actually younger people going and like shooting and mass, like it's done by young people, not by the old.
Mm-hmm.
Although, like, you think like, I mean, is American education system is really going to put these kind of things, like it's important to learn, this country is built on top of immigrated people.
Mm-hmm.
There are a lot of successful people, a lot of successful Hindus, a lot of successful Sikhs, a lot of successful Muslims.
Yeah.
Like, when will there be a system in America where people are educated, like, okay, I think it's not about racism, it's not about Muslim, Hindu, or Christianity, it's about like good and bad.
Mm.
It's just like you are differentiating by color the way you identify things, but it's not about that. Do you think, are we at that level? It's important for us to elevate this kind of thing so that, you know, we make a bigger impact rather than just pointing out these other things happen because we go on protesting again, and
right.
It looks like, oh, they're protesting, which is bad. Like, there's like, you're growing the gap rather than like, you know, trying to bridge the gap.
Yeah, no, that's a really good question. I think that there are probably many insights. I mean, I want to, maybe Zohra, you can start because you teach high school students and college students. So, I mean, in terms of the question around education, and then I can add on to it.
Actually, there are, I teach at Bard High School, early college. So what we've started doing there is bringing more awareness starting from the beginning, bringing earlier texts in. We were talking about reading Homer, but also reading the Mahabharata and also reading like the Persian epics at the same time. So we have this idea that we're all interconnected, even in, you know, before. And multiculturalism isn't a recent thing, which has been the work of teachers and education, is that it's much older, and that's the importance. So curriculum change is definitely happening. There are more Asian American studies courses, definitely African American studies. So I think curriculum change is happening, and they're getting probably more funding to be more, to include more texts into classrooms.
Mm-hmm.
It's just, it is going to take it takes a while, right? Mm-hmm. You wait for a while to get it approved, get it in the classrooms, get the kids to read it, mm-hmm. get the kids to not respond to each other, you know, negatively. But when it does work, and we brought it in this in our high school, it's really interesting how that impacts. We were talking before, Kavita was talking about the Ramayana and the Odyssey, and mm-hmm. we have these discussions, you know, mm-hmm. the Monkey King and Hanuman, and then, you know, sort of American Paul Bunyan stories, kind of connecting through that, for me, has been interesting. But definitely the work of political activism is something that takes a lot longer to mm-hmm. to sort of seep in. But this text is going to be in our classes next year.
It's going into paperback.
Yeah, so if it's paperback, definitely then.
Yeah.
But I'll pass that on.
No, I think you're right. I mean, you're as an educator, I think, like you said, curriculum change is key. Also, actively talking about race. You know, one of the things I ask people to do at the end of the book is to engage in race talks, to use those words and to talk about it more openly. Because I think that as Americans, we are afraid to even use that word, right? Race, racism, white supremacy, these are all words that people cringe about. But the more we talk about it, I actually think we get to what you said at the end, which is that we have more in common, right, than we don't. And this, the othering of which is what is happening, right, the othering, the division between who is the us and who makes up the other in the United States. A lot of that happens because we don't know our histories, we don't tell our stories, and we don't actually sit down and have those conversations where we realize that we are more connected than we thought. So I think starting with children is critical. I have a 5-year-old, and I often think about, you know, when is it appropriate to start introducing him to these sorts of conversations? I mean, he hears it in our house, but, you know, at the same time, like, when is he going to get it in school? I think it's important that we actually introduce these ideas around belonging, around the fact that some people are treated differently than others because of their color, because of their accent, because of where they come from, early on. So I'm a big believer in the education system changing. But at the same time, we are seeing the opposite, which is ethnic studies classes around the country are being dismantled and not defunded, right? That's that racial anxiety part. So the more that we organize to do what Zohra is saying and doing is critical so that we can get that education out there. Yeah.
So I don't know if it's a question, but I'd love to hear more about your this concept of racial bribe. Is that what you
mm-hmm.
call it? It's a fascinating concept, right? Because in some ways, everyone wants to fit in. And the question is, what are you trying to fit in to?
Right.
Right? And so where do you draw the line? When does it become acceptance of a racial bribe
mm-hmm.
versus trying to be part of a broader society that is
mm-hmm.
a certain way and
yeah.
call it white, call it whatever you
yeah.
want to do?
No, I think that's a great distinction. So when you accept the racial bribe, you're basically accepting and taking on a role in perpetuating and maintaining the racial hierarchy and the systems of racism, right? So that's the distinction when you go that far. So somebody who, I'll just use myself. So I'm an Indian immigrant, as you know, and when I came to the United States when I was 12, I had a very thick Indian accent. And I spent a lot of time, because I was bullied in school, trying to get rid of my accent. So I would listen to the nightly news and try to emulate what every anchor said, right, until I lost that accent. So that is, you know, that's not taking a racial bribe, right? That's the fitting in part. Wanting to fit in, not wanting to be called names all the time, right? But that's different than, say, actually getting to the point of, I think, what Kavita was saying earlier, of when we have things happening in our own community, like Apurvi Patel, or like even some of the, you know, the Hina, the undocumented immigrant I talked about, where our community then says, no, they're part of like that other. We don't talk about it. We're going to put, we're going to ignore it. We're going to even sometimes culturally shame and say that we're better. So that's an example of going too far, I think, and taking a racial bribe. Another example is what I talk about in the book around cultural exceptionalism, right? Where we have this narrative, especially South Asians, I think, do this, where we say we're the best. We're all spelling bee champions. We are all Silicon Valley entrepreneurs. We are the first. We are the best at everything. And it's because we have some cultural gene that enables us to be the best. Now, we all know that's not true, right? South Asians don't have any special cultural or biological imperative to succeed at anything more than others. But what they do have oftentimes is that they have access and benefits. So some South Asians came here speaking multiple languages. Some South Asians came here already educated, like my father. He's a doctor when he came here, already educated. So we had a step up. We had economic privilege and immigration privilege that enabled my brother and I to go to colleges, right, and to continue with our higher education. We had access, and so a lot of other communities in this country don't, for various reasons. So when we buy into that cultural exceptionalism, when we start to do the cultural shaming, those are examples of when we start to take that racial bribe, and we then maintain the ladder instead of dismantle it. Does that help?
Follow-up question, yes.
Yeah.
I think, so doesn't that sort of, the hierarchy, or, so I was going to ask, isn't it a cultural bribe also in some ways, even in India, for example? So I grew up, I was in India for 22 years before I came here. Accent, all similar things.
Yeah.
Not because I was made fun of, but just because it was easier to fit in them.
Sure.
But there's also a cultural aspiration that goes on even within India, right? Within different classes. And in some ways, is it a racial bribe that you're accepting, or is there also this cultural aspect of the otherness and being more educated and this, that, and the other, versus someone who is the more blue-collar people? You know what I mean?
That everyone wants to succeed, right?
Exactly.
But I think everyone wants to succeed. Black people want to succeed. Latinos want to succeed. Indigenous people, we all want to, everybody wants to succeed. And everyone wants their children to be educated. And everyone wants a good job and a fair living wage. But what happens in this country because of that racial hierarchy and the systems is that some people get left out completely, right? And so, for example, we have a system in which the people who are living more on the other side of the poverty line tend to be Black communities or Latino communities. And so oftentimes, Asian Americans are pitted against them and are told, well, how come you're succeeding and you don't seem to need any special privileges or benefits? Why can't they do the same? And so that's another example of that, the wedge, the coming in between us, right? Putting pause on those sorts of racial narratives that we hear is one way that we can disrupt and interrupt that racial ladder entirely. So when Asian Americans stop buying into that and they say, no, we're not model minority, we're not all model minorities, we're not even going to buy into that, right? We have disparities in our own community, plus we don't want to be the wedge. And we're going to look at this from a system standpoint. So what can our housing system do better? What can our education system do better? So that all people have access to opportunity in the same way.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Great. Anyone else?
So one of the issues that you raised was the situation of Ahmed Mohammed, the kid who brought the clock to school. And I think what was really interesting about his story and his family's story is that after they went through this ordeal, which was really trying, then they also saw this other side of America, the, the welcoming multicultural side, and Mark Zuckerberg invited him to Facebook, and he was told he could go to MIT whenever he wanted to, but something about the experience really turned them off, and so they decided instead to accept an offer from a very wealthy Qatari foundation that provided for their whole family to move to Qatar, and he's in some kind of a program there. And, you know, that made me think of something that my friends say all the time, which is, oh, if Donald Trump wins the election, I'm going to move to Canada, and I would, or somewhere else, so like Dubai. And I was wondering, like, is there a part of this when you think about immigrants, people who think, okay, well, I'm also part of this global class, and there are other places that I can live that are better for me than America, and it's another way to accept yourself out of this difficult racial struggle that we have here.
Yeah, I mean, you know, I think, I mean, I can't speak to, you know, I can't comment on why the family accepted the offer, but I think that you're right that generally speaking, we have come to a point in this country where many immigrants feel that maybe we're better off at home or the home, you know, whatever country we come from or somewhere else, because the concept of the American dream, which has never really been real, it hasn't actually been offered to people of color at all, but it's just that narrative, right? The concept of the American dream doesn't make any sense anymore. Because if you're struggling to even, if you're struggling in terms of you can't even go to your mosque because there's a huge anti-Islam rally right at your mosque, right? And you can't send your children there. I mean, that is a significant intrusion in terms of how you live your life. So I think you're right. I mean, I don't know any data particularly, but I do know of anecdotes where people feel that it's not worth it to struggle in a country where constantly people are having to make decisions that take away their ability to express their national origin, their language, their faith, and they don't want to fight anymore. But I think at the same time, it's important that we do, you know, and I think that I'm not sure that it's any better, to be quite honest, in other parts of the world either, because I think that all across the world, there seem to be these trends. You know, if you look at Europe, there is tremendous anti-refugee sentiment there. There are rallies in certain European cities that are actually very clear that they're anti-Muslim. You know, parts of South Asia, right? I mean, so there is conflict, whether it's class, whether it's communal, whether it's racial, in, I think, all parts of the world. So we are seeing these differences because we were part of that global community that you talk about. So my hope is that, you know, people will stay and dig their heels in, you know? And when my friends say that we're going to move if Trump gets elected, my response is, no, we have to actually dig in even more. And really fight for what we believe and create the country and the experiences that we want for our children.
It's beautiful. So she talks a lot about young South Asians, and I don't mean to call you out, but I see some young South Asians. I'm going to put my teacher voice on and say,
you're going to force them to ask the final question.
Yes, I really would love to hear from. Don't feel pressured. I'm not going to grade you, but it would be nice. Mm-hmm. Yes.
Thank you so much for being here.
No, thanks.
I really appreciate listening to your talk. I've been wanting to come for several events that you've announced, so this is really amazing. So I was at a conference recently, and I really appreciate your conversation about how it's important to have these race talks. Mm-hmm. So I was at a conference recently to talk about race and racism and dismantling racism and systems. Mm-hmm. I think one of the things that I found challenging that resonated with what you were talking about is, you know, I still feel like a lot of times these race talks are still very much kind of this white and black, you know, binary.
Right.
Like what you were talking mm-hmm. about when you were, you know, this point of entry, I think is still very real mm-hmm. today. And one of the challenges that I struggle with is how do you then interject and, you know, disrupt those type of conversations to make sure that, you know, these narratives that we continue mm-hmm. to form and perpetuate are much more inclusive mm-hmm. and critical about what race really means, mm-hmm. You know, in the landscape that it is right now.
Yeah.
So I still feel really challenged, like, in these conversations.
So I think that one way that I have seen it become more inclusive, as you said, or broader, is I do think that it's important to acknowledge and validate that for hundreds of years, the way that we have thought about race has been in a black or white binary. And it still is in many parts of the country. And that's important to acknowledge because, as I mentioned earlier, the systems of oppression in this country, when you look at the criminal justice system, when you look at housing and segregation, when you look at education, are actually founded on anti-blackness and perpetuate anti-black racism. So it is important to, I think, acknowledge and validate that. And then to draw the point that because anti-black racism exists, all these other isms against our communities are made possible. So because we have a system that incarcerates so many black men in this country, it is has been very easy for the government to create another system, the deportation state, that actually sends Latino people and Asian people into detention. And drawing from that, it has been very easy for the government to create the war on terror, So the war on crime, the war on immigrants, the war on terror. And the war on terror has affected the communities I write about through surveillance and national security policies. So I think it's important to draw that link and to say that the systems were founded on anti-Black racism and indigenous racism as well, but that they are then perpetuated against multiple other communities. So that's why, as you talked about in the beginning, we have, like, it's not just as interpersonal racism, it's really about addressing the systems and the structures that exist. And so for that, we do have to talk about the movement for Black lives, or to say Black Lives Matter, right? But I think that's one way I've seen it happen, where you acknowledge it and you validate it, but then you draw the connections to other forms of oppression, that it, from that, you know, from that poisonous tree, we have other poisonous fruit mm-hmm. that includes Asian, Latino, Arab, South Asian Muslim communities as well.
Yeah. This is great. Thank you. Thank you. So I think what we'll have now is the book signing. If you'd like to come talk to her.
Yeah, I hope you do.
Yeah,
so I would love to meet
thank
you.
Thank you so much for coming. Thank you for those wonderful questions. Thank you, Deepa, for those wonderful answers and for digging your heels in.
Thank you to Zohra and to Anthony for pulling this together. And appreciate you guys coming out on a Friday evening. Really do. That's commitment. So, yes, I'll be up here. I'm signing and selling books. Books are $20 discount if you're interested in getting one for a family or friend.